Oh, this will be perfect because I can do my hair whilst. You're right. As you string cheese.
It really is.
Welcome, 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 everyone. To a special late night edition of Beacon Hills After Dark. Literally the after dark.
I was going to say, do they even know what time it is?
Well, we know what time it is. So if we're talking a little slow, that's why. Because we're tired. It is Snowmageddon Part 2 here. And so outside is just like a freaking blizzard. Mm-hmm. And
I decided to camp over.
Yep, I told Mama, I was like, come on over, spend the night. It'll be fun. Oh my God. So we recorded the podcast.
And my response was like, I don't have anything else to do.
Exactly. That's usually how it works out. But you know, it's all good. And so I made chili and it's delicious. Mm-hmm. Yay.
Bowl number two.
And that girl, yep. It's nice and warming because it is cold outside and it's extremely stupid. And I don't appreciate it. Mm. Okay. We're going to jump right into it. Q&A's for codominance, which I still don't fully understand, but science, I don't know. I'm also going to be doing my hair during this, so.
I did my hair during the podcast.
Exactly.
Someone should have been doing it during the podcast.
I should have, but I was busy, like, moderating.
The prison.
So people keep asking me this.
Who does that?
They keep asking me, you know, who is reversion? Who is Mr. Reversion and the steric conundrum? First of all, please stop getting me and Cole's post mixed up. Because we have two completely different thought processes when it comes to it. And I can't answer for him.
Is it because you guys talk all the time?
Yeah. Yeah. But, and I think we are the two people who actually did, like, really comprehensive posts and had people that we talked to about it and that mm-hmm. kind of thing. So,
I love Cole.
They're like, oh, Cole. Who backed out? Was it Dobb or was it Tyler? Was it Dobb or was it Tyler? I don't know. I have my thoughts and theories. He has his thoughts and theories.
Who does he
think? I can't really go. I think he says Hoechlin.
I think Hoechlin too.
But,
you think Dobbs?
No, I don't think
Dobbs. You think it's just Jeff being stupid?
I think that it was just a business decision. I think regardless of whoever made that decision, mm-hmm. it was inconsequential at the time because of Shelley. And yeah. really because of everything else that was
going
on. They
thought it was
going
to work out and it didn't.
Yeah.
No, I'll be honest, I think it was Hex too.
One thing they did say is that I still think Dobb backed out because of his loyalty to Tyler Posey. And that's why Tyler Posey hasn't gloated about Dobb and Tyler Hoechlin not wanting to do steric. I had heard that theory too, and I actually, there's a lot of weight to that theory,
mm-hmm.
but,
that makes sense.
But man, if that's the case, there are already enough reasons to hate Tyler Posey. There are already enough reasons for him to be so petty. And to be so jealous that if it came down to Dobb decided not to do steric because of Posey, I don't think that's something we're ever going to find out because I don't think it would ever go public.
I mean, I want someone to do a tell-all just like
the public. I want someone to do a tell-all. They would never tell-all with that. Too many people would be affected and it would just be done.
I don't give a fuck.
Well, we don't, but, you know, everyone else does. Because evidently, and thank you all the 90s that sent me links. During the Larry King special, they asked Posey what he thought about Charlie Carver coming out. And evidently, he told some story about, like, little boys holding hands. So, we're going to take a look at that in a minute and see what's going on.
What does that have to do with anything?
And I know it's going to be some convoluted mess. And I'm like, Posey, if you would have just apologized... You wouldn't have to do any of this.
Yeah.
All you had to do was say, hey, man, I was salty about steric, and I ended up insulting a whole lot of people that weren't supposed to be included in that. I'm sorry. Just say that. And I know that he was talked to, and he refused, so whatever. It's easy to say a lot of things, but the option of... Oh, I'm sorry. I know. Hopefully one day.
Someone told me.
This is why I love and I hate our nanny. He's in equal regards. It says, this is just ridiculousness, so feel free to ignore it. But if you feel like writing a fic sticky about Styles getting the bite so he doesn't have to worry about hemorrhoids on his bussy, that would be amazing. Like, that's the only reason he ever wanted to change his species, is to keep it looking pretty.
God dang it, now I want to write it.
Don't write it, please.
It'd be the shortest Styles gets the bites Derek fic ever.
Do not write that.
Stuart would be like, you only want to get the bite to keep your bussy looking fresh. And Styles is like, yeah.
Where's Georgie to make some damn sense into you? Just not. Jocelyn, knock some sense into her. Someone. Ethan.
Ethan is on board. You know good and well. No. Ethan is on board. No. In fact, I'm going to make him co-write it with me. Ethan, you don't co-write it with me, Ethan.
Talk some sense into this hoe. Okay?
In fact, I'm not even going to publish that ass so I can remember it and keep it in the inbox.
That is some fucking weird ass shit.
Cue for the Q&A. Do you think that the reason Scott went after Kira instead of Liam was because he knew for sure she'd come back to him / be on his side? Because Kira never hurt him or betrayed him, not counting when she was Cray because of her fox, or even disagreed with him, unlike Liam or Styles or Lydia. She's always been loyal and an ally and would be the easiest pack member to get back. Also, a very important thing to realize and recognize about Kira is this, and then...
That's where she's going. I mean, Kira does need it because, you know. Let's be honest. Kira does need to get it on because they've been kind of, every single time they want to get it in, they're like. Because
he looked at Liam and Liam was like, I'm so sorry, Daddy. And he was like, I can't deal with you. I need to drive 17 hours to New Mexico so I can get my fox pussy, basically.
He wants to get it in. Okay, let him do that. But no, I actually agree. Kira would be the easiest out of this pack to actually get back.
But because she doesn't know what's going on.
Well, that too. But she really has been a ride or die bitch. Like, mm-hmm. She's been ride or die from day one. And, I mean, I give her props for that. That's why she's one of my faves.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, if he had his original pack or, like, the middle pack that had, like, overlapped with Derek's pack, he would have easier times to get to people. But with this current pack, that I don't know how to describe them.
It's not a pack, it's a peck.
Kira really is the easiest one to get, mm-hmm. followed by Lydia, but Lydia, unfortunately, is locked up in a fucking crazy ward in her own mind. So, you have the only two people I could think of automatically, because let's be honest, Styles is like number three. I guess, are they doing the road trip together?
Yeah.
That's probably why. They're going to make them get back together on this road trip, because, you know, every time that they go on the road, like on the bus or something, they have a little bonding experience.
Oh, Lord. I can't deal.
So,
Electra Swan. Oh, we talked about this a little bit on the podcast. It says, I hope everyone screaming about what Hoechlin said realizes how homophobic it was. I don't care if he's a closeted gay man himself. Still homophobic. What he's saying is, I'm not like one of those guys. I'm mask. I like sports and not some limp-wristed fairy. And she says, when and where did Hoechlin say this? He didn't, dear. Don't worry. That Nani was off the rails, and I understand, and I get it, and I sympathize with you, and I understand what you're going through. This was not the occasion. Hoechlin will give you plenty of occasions. Do not worry.
Like when he was on the beach.
Be messy. Exactly. Alina Gerber was the perfect
I was not representation. Say that. I was thinking that, say it, but this one right here just can't even hold herself back.
But no. So yeah, boo, you're going to have to let this one go. I know. You're going to have to let this one go, but don't worry. When it comes back up, and it will, I will be right there with you, and we will just drag from here to eternity. But you're not going to get it on this one. Sorry, bae.
I'm going to put my...
Oh, you want a blanket?
Oh, no, I have a blanket in my bag.
Okay.
But I'm just kind of cold, so I'm putting my hair thing on. Which, cool. This is not really a hoodie, but I'm going to work with it.
So it says...
It's not enough anyway.
where are people only getting 600K or CW ratings? Everything I find says it to be over 900,000, which unfortunately isn't as bad as I was hoping. Or forgiven the numbers for the earlier episodes, just a bit of a drop. I don't know why you think that, Nani. They went from the beginning of season 5. Here, let's do this. Let's take a look real quick. And I think this is one of their PR people, because they do that little thing where they're like, oh, it's not really bad, unfortunately. And I'm like, no, it's really bad. And you suck. Oh, look at this. Someone said the drop in ratings between when people were watching the show for the right reasons versus them watching it for the wrong reasons. And it went from 2.4 million to the top of season 5 was like just under 1.1.
They used to do it so
well. So yeah, no, they've taken a huge hit. And I don't think their Live Plus 3 and their Live Plus 7 numbers are justifying it. Now, no one said anything about 600K except in hopes and wishes. They were like, by the middle of the season, it's possible we could get 600K. That would be amazing. I think that it is going to go down again next week, because this is crazy. I think the Allison Argent episode is going to give them a little bit of a bump, but God, it's not for a while. So we'll see what happens. Hold on. No, boo. It's a pretty big drop. We talk about this on the Q&A. Cool. And Al. Roscoe's private placement now for what? Crappy old Jeeps? LMAO. Exactly. Yeah, no. Roscoe isn't private placement. We actually talked about that during the podcast. I don't believe so, at least. I think that was actually kind of a nod to the fans. But again, with that entire episode, I think it was just too little too late. I love that hemorrhoids question so much. I've been busy, so I haven't been able to watch 513 until now. But Scott could smell Brayden's motorcycle exhaust. I'm sorry, what? And he could smell Malia's chemo signals, but needed Styles to help lift a shelf while being able to fight off two Chimeras at the same time in the next scene. Was he just faking lying about being weak the whole time? I don't know where Scott's moral compass is, especially when it comes to lying to Styles and to lying and withholding information from his friends and pack. He's got a lot of explaining to do. I'm really hoping that this weekend we can get with Lunar Advent. He is our Scott stan, and I want to do like an In Defense of Scott McCall episode with him, so that we can be like, we need to get to the bottom of this thing once and for all. So keep your fingers crossed that that happens, because we need to know some information about Scott. Hey boo, are you available tomorrow, late morning / early afternoon for a Scott podcast? So we'll see what he says. Child, we don't know. We talk about this on the Q&A. I'm a Steric Stadia shipper, and I have to say that the Stadia scene they release for next week's episode is the first really well done one all season. We get a glimpse into Styles' old genuine self. Preemptively, I agree. They're gonna find a way to mess it up. So, you know, enjoy it. The Stadia scene for next week.
Oh, God, they're gonna mess up everything.
Yeah, they're gonna find a way to mess it up.
Just like I said, they're gonna probably kill off just because I like Mason and Corey.
Mm-hmm. I think that they are going to, I think they are alluding to Stydia. I think the fact that, you know, Styles is trying to find someone to save so that he can save himself, and Malia standing right over there trying to kill her mama and needs saving, but then we see Styles in the hospital with Lydia holding her hand, and we know that he's going to save her.
They have a better history, too. They have a better exactly. chemistry. It just would have been the smarter choice anyway than going to Marish mm-hmm. and... Malia. Just saying the ship name makes me want to throw up.
It's just so gross.
But, no, I agree. I mean, like, they've taken that one but two wrong steps when it comes to just letting the ship happen naturally. It was right there for them. So, might just as well. I mean, Paris is going to be her stalker slash protector anyway, so I think he'll probably get killed off too just protecting her, but who knows. And, I mean, Malia wants to get in on Theo's, you know.
Please let that happen. I need Malia. I think that would be such an interesting twist.
She would be so
much
more tolerable if she just got a little D from him. Like, just give her a little taste of
with
it.
With Theo, it wouldn't be no little D.
That's true. But I'm just saying, think about their chemistry versus hers with Sal. Just think about that. That whole fight scene
with chemistry
was everything. Everything. And he enjoyed it way too much. Getting knocked down. And she enjoyed it way too much hitting him. So, I mean, like, right there, that wrote, like, 500 fics.
Mm-hmm.
Just give the people what they want. I know Jeff won't do that. But at least I can hope, okay? I'm a believer. I am an optimist. You don't call me Del Romo for nothing.
So, someone says only 605,000 views per tweet. Well, those are actually the Twitter numbers, which... oh yeah, the tweets were that low. R.E., the regarding the episode being all Skiles, completely agree. Their chemistry has evaporated, though. They were supposed to have this whole reconciliation, but I'm not feeling it. I'm not sure if the show intended for it to seem like there's an obvious rift between them still, or if it's the results of Dobbs just going through the motions. Scott's a moron, and Styles has seriously outgrown him, even with the character assassination on the writer's part. We talk a lot about this during the podcast, and honestly, I felt like we said it, you know, Scott can't apologize. Just say you're sorry. Just say, I'm sorry, I believe Theo. That was crazy of me. It won't happen again, or, you know, whatever. I love you, something. But they keep leaving this open-ended that makes it look like Styles actually did kill this guy. And it's not what happened in any sense of the narrative. And so, yeah, we talk a lot about that. It was messy. Let's see. Talk a lot about this. The if you're watching the show only for the ships, you're doing it for the wrong reasons. Guy had a change of heart, SMH, so hard. I don't know if it's only him, but I think in the near future they're going to do heavily marketing. There we go. The show is ships again. They don't have anything else, but I don't know at this point if people care. First of all, they're not going to start. They're going to continue. As long as they're heterosexual ships, we are going to have them all day. Friggin' Layden and, who was the other, male, female, or Kieran, Scott, I guess, Skira. Maury, Mason and Corey. It's happening. It's gonna happen. Maury. Yeah, not the daddy, not the daddy, not the daddy, not the daddy.
I think you've been drinking too much.
And so,
why did you call them Maury, though? You could have given them any name. What's Mason's last name?
Girl. Hewitt.
Oh, I was going to say Glow Factor.
I know, right? So then we have Hori. You want it to be Hori?
Well, no. Hewry. Usually, I thought if they usually do that, they usually go with both of them.
We don't know Corey's last name.
Bottom.
Hey, ha! Hugh Bottom?
Long Bottom.
Hugh Bottom?
Long Bottom.
Hewitt.
Okay.
Hugh Bottom?
Okay.
Bottom it?
I like the first one. No. Maury. Please, people, come up with a better ship name. Just
you are not the father.
For what baby? We don't believe in impact in this world, okay?
We actually got a question about that, but I want to wait till we get Meg and all them on, because it was a question for everybody. So, okay. On the podcast, on the Q&A. And, oh, okay, and why is this the second time that hospital bills, no job having Styles has fixed that windshield? Because he stole that money, and that's why he stole that money.
Exactly. Styles stole that money. He stole that money real quick, and he was just like, no one's gonna find out.
She said, no, but how does he afford all this crap?
And let's be honest, his daddy's on affordable health care now, so, you mean...
He on that Obamacare. Because they most likely still have hospital visits from, hospital bills from Claudia, then his MRI, and stay at the Eichen house, even though that was wiped.
So?
Then his dad's hospital bill for the 2 days, both with major surgery, even with insurance, that's a lot of money to pay.
Wait, did we include Styles when he had his MRI? Because I got an MRI. Put that in. Okay, cause I was going to say, yeah. I was like, I got an MRI, and that shit was expensive as fuck.
Styles has a side gig as a whore. That's the only explanation. We talk about this on the Q&A.
I don't know how she has so much energy at this time of night.
So someone keeps linking me to a certain Scott stan when they're sending in links and that kind of thing. So I think it is that Scott stan, but here's the issue.
That's Scott's... Yes. Which one?
That one. That certain Scott stan has us blocked. So even if I did go to her thing, I can't reblog anything. But I'm like, if you have us blocked, but you're constantly following us, then what's the point? That's why I never block anybody, because I'm like, hey, I don't need to block you. So you think that she's
blocked us?
Oh, no, she has blocked us.
So she's the one sending the question.
I think she's the one sending the question, because, I mean, I get them consistently, and they're always linking her blog. So either she has a super stan that's a stan of us and of her, but she's a huge Scott stan, so I don't see that happening. Why don't we just go on
my page and let me see what the hell she said.
Oh, I mean, we can see her stuff, I just can't reblog it. And so they send me all these links, I can't reblog anything from her page. And I was like, I ain't going to the trouble of trying to download all your crap just so I can repost it. Ain't no one got time for that. Okay, I do want to listen. We're going to listen to this, so it is going to be audio for a minute, you guys, but you'll be all right.
What is this?
Oh, and already he's lying. Tyler Posey. Like, seriously, what is wrong with you?
Do you know Charlie? You keep in touch with Charlie?
Absolutely.
Do you think this will affect, is he not in the cast anymore?
He's not, no. He and his twin brother left the cast a couple seasons ago.
Have you spoken to him since he announced it?
I didn't know. I had no idea. This is the first time hearing of that. But I've known. I've definitely known. That's so great, man. Oh, my God. I had no idea.
Does it mean anything anymore?
Wait.
What does that mean anymore? It's come out from the cast.
I think it's getting easier and easier to deal for people. Like, the other day, I was driving by these two kids wearing backpacks in high school, and they were holding hands, boys, and I loved it. I thought it was so cool, man.
That was a great world.
Really, man. I really, really dug it. I thought it was really cool.
I've gone to school with people holding hands. They were male and female and gay and lesbian. No one fucking cared, but...
So Tyler
Posey. He also lives in California. Is he telling me he's never seen anyone before that?
Tyler Posey.
No, I want to know that. Is he saying this was the first time he's seen a gay couple hold hands?
Tyler Posey was driving down the street and saw two men with backpacks.
And no, there were two boys. Two he saw boys. Two high school boys, maybe junior high school boys, which is impossible because they're everywhere. I've seen so many, like,
but no, they were holding hands. Tyler Posey assumed they were gay. And said, that's great, man. That's real. What a world we live in. That's the dumbest thing he has ever said in life.
Can I just say, it is common in Japan for friends of the same sex to hold hands.
They could be brothers. They could be cousins. You know, the whole point is that you looked at them and you judged them immediately because they were holding hands.
My friend Rie is from Japan, and the first thing she did when she met me was grab my hand and start walking with me. She's like, we're just going to walk together like this. Common practice there. There's nothing. We're both. She's married with a kid, and I know people who would have assumed we were lesbians because they saw us holding hands. We're just friends.
I've done that with Juanita, where like I was about to walk out.
Before.
Yeah. I was about to walk out into the street, Megan, and she grabbed my hand, and then we just kept, she was like, I guess I gotta hold your hand now, Meg, because you're gonna kill yourself.
You can even vouch for this. Meg and I hold hands all the time. We grope each other, we hold each other, and we are the straightest people ever.
It's different for girls. Girls can do that stuff, boys can't.
I will show you straight boys that I know that will hold each other too. My friend Isaac and Justin are very close. They're like best friends or brothers or whatever. And they're the first ones to say twinsies and hold each other's hand. And they're both straight. One's engaged. The other one, I don't know if he's still engaged. They might not be out. But come on, people. Really? Like,
why did he tell that story?
So I have a question, though. He said he always knew, and then he's like, I don't know. That was weird for me.
He said he didn't hear that Charlie had come out, which is an obvious lie because everybody knew. Like, I mean, everybody was talking about it. There's no way you absolutely did not hear about it. Mm-hmm. I think the reason he said that is because he didn't respond. He was one of the few people of the cast that didn't tweet about it. Excuse me. That didn't tweet about it or that didn't tweet their support.
Yeah.
The problem is, Tyler Posey is extremely homophobic, and there's no way around it. To have an answer like that and not understand why that's a terrible answer, because the problem is that he has fans that don't understand why that's a terrible answer. Friends, I told you, when I was in school, there was a girl who I still maintain to this day that she's biracial, but she insists that she's white, and I'm like, okay. But
there are those people. Remember, there was that documentary about that girl who found out that she was black, even though black people had been telling her the entire time of her school that she was black, but she didn't find out because she grew up with her white family, and most of the people at her school was white, so she assumed that she was white too, and she found out that her mom had an affair and wasn't actually in love with her dad. All this whole stuff,
but
she found out she was part black. There's a lot of people who don't sometimes. They don't know the hidden secrets of their family. They also don't know the history.
They don't want to admit it. And they're just like, okay. Well,
there's also the people who don't know the history of white passing.
Mm-hmm.
And there are people who would literally white pass and then for generations don't tell their family.
Yeah, I'm not talking about all that. But
so she might have some issues. She might have some reasons why she
she definitely has issues. But so she went to a basketball game and and it was in like Bohunk, Nebraska, you know. And so when the guys called her, you N-word or whatever, and she was just like, sir, I am not an N-word. And she looked really proud, like, oh, I fought the cause, you know, Black Lives Matter, you know, all this other stuff. And I was like, why, what? Because all you did was say, don't call me an N-word because I'm not black. So therefore, black people are N-words, you know, and she was just like,
she said, you can't call me that, but you can call everyone else
exactly.
That.
But she thought that she was 100% in the right, and all her little friends thought that she was just so cool for standing up for injustice. And so now we have Tyler Perry talking about, I like to troll in front of middle schools looking at children.
Is he
and
Mark
I hope
Sally?
I find someone that holds hands.
God,
so,
can
you
just make a Mark Sally joke?
Oh my God. And I'm like, you're going, I said, you just put yourself in a stupid spot because you're freaking homophobic. I need you to deal with this, Tyler. I need you to get over Steric, get over yourself, get over all of that.
I want this girl to do an ID of her family and find out.
Girl.
It would probably blow her.
I want Tyler Posey to, I want Jesse Posey to come out. You know, I want someone in his family, like...
Well, they say everyone knows someone gay anyway.
Exactly. I just feel like... Because he's like, oh, yeah, of course, I've known. I've known all along. I've always known he was gay. And I'm like, good for you? You know, like... But you didn't know when he came out, even though you keep in touch all the time and blah, blah, blah. Like, you're such a liar. And it's so unnecessary. Such an unnecessary lie. Here, I will go ahead and post these videos. We talk about this on the Q&A. Thank you for the submission. That's so disheartening because there are kind of two sets of young people. We have the young people who are like the future of tomorrow and who are going to kind of push us into like a more democratic direction and where there's progress and change. And then you have that section of young people that are just so stunted and they're also growing up. And so they're all going to grow up together and they're going to be the ones who just F it up for everyone else.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised, like, Posey voted Republican, you know, like, if he votes. I doubt he probably even votes.
I was going to say, does he vote?
Yeah. My God. I swear. Videos, submission. Thank you. Oh, that's unfortunate. Okay, let's go to the next page. When Scott...
Did I really just say Amandala is a self-proclaimed film nerd? Like, you know this girl's an actress. You know she's been in films.
It's so stupid.
Like, the way they try to reduce her nerddom and reduce her, like, knowledge of racism and film and stuff like that, like, it bugs me so much when magazines and papers do that. Because I'm just like, you do realize this girl knows a lot for her age.
Mm-hmm.
And she's has very the knowledge. Smart. And, I mean, you can be that age and know films.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I watched a lot of classic films. Like, I grew up watching classic films from the 40s, 50s, and 60s with my grandma.
Mm-hmm.
At a young age. So trust me, we can know these films.
Oh, me and my sister lived on Turner Classic.
Yeah.
The issue is that, like, why does that make you a film nerd?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm like...
But the thing is, they put it in quote-unquotes, too. Mm-hmm. I was just like, really? I was just like...
Well, that's such a weird thing.
What age do you have to be a film nerd? I know there's people who don't believe black people can be film nerds. Is it that she's black that she can't be film nerds? Because I remember people saying that she didn't know anything about racism. And I'm like, well, I guess you didn't know anything about how she dealt with the hungry.
Or her, exactly.
But, yeah. Messy. I was just looking at that and I just like...
So when Scott reads about Damnatio Memoriae in the car, we clearly see the text. And it says, he lured children to his shop in Paris, where he would rape them, kill them, and boil the flesh off their bones to eat. But when Scott reads it, he leaves out the rape part. Like, seriously? The same show that has had multiple rape, non-con, dub-con sex scenes and torture scenes can't even say the word rape? Is that hitting too close to home, Jeff? It's not romantic enough. I mean, if it had ended up with the parish guy falling in love with the kids... And then marrying their bones and eating them and using little toothpicks to clean them out of his teeth, then, you know, they would definitely say rape because then it's very sweet. And it really just gets to the heart of
it. Is this Dark Stacy coming out?
No, it's Romancing the Sticky. That's what this, Romancing the Sticky. Because Jeff understands romance. And I feel like... If this story had a romantic, it was on its way. I mean, it's on its way. Little kids, probably little boys holding hands, wearing backpacks. He saw these little boys and he picked them up and he raped them and then he skinned them and he boiled their bones for meat and ate them. Very, very romantic. Probably going to meet Styles at some point and they can start dating. And then, you know, go from there. Mess.
I don't even know how to respond to that.
Girl. Yes. We talk about this on the quad and all. So, someone sent me some fic recs, which I'll post a little bit later. They posted about this series called Sustainable Management.
I just read The Giving Tree and I was like, what?
I enjoy, I've read that series. I've actually read a lot of that author's work. That author and I have a problem. And
I was going to say, is this like some weird version of Shades of Grey?
No.
Oh, thank God.
But he does a lot of Peter Styles and Derek. And usually Derek is always bottom. Styles is usually the alpha or something like that. And then Peter is kind of verse and switching between Styles and Derek.
Peter?
Yeah. And so...
Peter.
Oh, girl, yeah. It would work. My main issue, he's a very good writer. Very creative. But there are times when the positioning drives me insane. Because all of a sudden, someone will be sucking someone off. But then the next thing you know, they're like on their back, and then they're on their stomach, and then the person's above them, but then they're below them.
Look, sometimes that's how sex happens, okay?
Yeah.
It's just flipping all around.
Then I
don't know anything about that, but I heard that.
And then there was something about, like, so I asked him, you know, I was like, I don't quite understand his job. And is he actually having sex with the ground? And what does that do? And he was like, I explained it thoroughly. And I was like, okay. So I don't care. I mean, it's like, there are enough other authors. Although I do, you know, I'll wreck this person. I have a few friends that absolutely adore him. We just don't see eye to eye, unfortunately. Yeah. I don't like the idea of Posey saying, yeah, it's getting easy. I don't like Larry King talking about, oh, so it came out, who cares? I understand what he was trying to do, but it didn't work because it is still a very big deal.
Yeah.
And, I mean, they need to accept that. It's rude and it's dismissive to think that it's not.
There's people who are acting like gay people have had a chance to come out
since,
you know,
beginning of time. We've been waiting for you.
No. I'm like, I know a lot of people who are still very afraid. In 2002, this is one of my personal
2016.
But I'm just saying, like, one of my friends was super afraid to come out to her family. I know people who were the same way even in college, and there's still people coming. There's still reasons people are not coming out. I mean, you can still lose your job in this modern day and age to coming out. And if people don't believe it, you can look up damn state laws. There's still the state laws that have permission or trying to get permission to not even allow people to come into their fucking restaurant now if they are gay. Like,
if they're wearing backpacks and holding hands.
So, I mean, like, don't act like...
How dare
don't
he?
Don't act like people who are gay have the same freaking rights as every person else, because that's not true.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So, yes, it is still surprising when people are still coming out. Because a lot of people had to live in fear for a long time that they wouldn't even... I remember people didn't want to come out gay because of the AIDS crisis.
Oh, God, I know. That?
Like, a lot of young people don't know
and
that.
That
was one of the major things, is that if you came out gay, automatically people assumed you had AIDS. If you had AIDS, automatically people assumed you were gay. It was all types of craziness.
Well, and then this, again...
And it was just, it was wrong.
This, again, is the issue with America.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're only talking about white gays. Let's not talk about Latino gays and black gays and Asian gays. That's a whole nother ball game that y'all ain't even nowhere near ready for.
Talk about the people that were killed.
That are killed and beat on the daily. Oh, but you don't. Oh, but no, it's so easy to come out now. It's like, sit
down. Just 2 years ago in DC, which is one of the more open places for being gay, there was a black gay guy who got beat up and almost killed because he was gay. There's been girls who have been lesbian who have been attacked by groups of guys. There's been, God, in Philly. Ugh, when I was up in Philly, some shit was happening up there. And one of the reasons I was even in our Queer Straight Alliance is because they wanted to make sure that kids who were gay, who went to our school and to the other schools that were, to the other colleges that were related, was so that they had safe places to go. So... that's one of those things where I'm just like, please don't act like this shit is all hunky-dory and so easy. I mean, minorities in general, they don't have it easy. They don't have it equal. And it is hard, especially, that's why I do believe in intersection and stuff like that, because the thing is that you cannot forget that women also come in different races. You can't forget that people of other colors come being gay, and everyone has an experience, and experiences are always different. Sorry. I had a friend who went through a really bad experience, and he passed away because of that. And it's just, it's very hard.
Mm.
It's very hard to talk about knowing and loving people who are gay or lesbian, and knowing the stuff, you know, having friends that have been raped and stuff like that, just knowing stuff like that. It's just, it's hard. Sorry.
I know.
Sorry. Like, oh. Tyler Posey and Larry King pissed me off for a second. I used to like Larry King, but that pissed me off.
Yeah, that was ugly. And he's going to get praised for it.
He's going to get praised for it, and it's not deserving.
That's unfortunate. That's very unfortunate. So, someone says, no question about the episode, since nothing was worth even thinking twice about. But why are you so perfect? I said, because of nannies like you, boo. Thank you. So a bunch of people have been listening to the old episodes. I'm like, oh my God. But it's like, we got so much stuff wrong.
Well, we had stuff wrong, but let's be honest.
Well, because we had hopes and expectations.
But, I mean, we had that glimmer in our eye, like I said before, but our old episodes are actually really good.
Yeah.
And they're really funny. Mm-hmm. And as several people keep pointing out to me, you can definitely hear when certain people, mainly you and Meg, were getting a little sloshed. I really do think that we should go back to having our display of food for our podcast, introducing what food we have, and introducing what drinks.
That way, when we are smacking during the podcast, they'll know what we were eating. Because we smack a lot, but it's all good.
They can actually tell what we're drinking. Because, like I said, Ryan last week poured some daggone wine on there, and I was like, where was my glass?
Right. I contacted him the next morning, and I was like, how are you doing? He was like, I'm good, but the wine. And I was like, oh no, too much wine.
I mean, people forget we have a drinking game for a reason.
Yeah, we need to update that. God,
Josh was supposed to update that.
I'll make him update it. He was drinking the other night. He'll get us a nice one. I need a hair tie.
What's Josh not drinking, though?
This is also true. Do you have a hair tie? Just something I can...
I just have the one that's in my hair. I didn't bring it over.
Okay, here's what we're going to do. Someday... Walk in the bed of the beautiful sun.
Oh, I thought for a hot second you were about to go into Kid Rock and say, my name is Kid. And I was like,
why?
Because you went to that deep bass and I was like, oh. Bomb to the bomb. I'm like, what?
Bomb, dig it up, jump, bum, bum, yay.
I thought it was fun.
So, okay. You know, I'm getting so tired of people fighting the dread doctors. Because they always go for the parts of the body that are covered in metal. Like, you have claws. They have metal masks. Don't try to claw at their faces. Go for the parts that are covered in fabric and say, use some logic, please. But no, they go for the metal parts, and then they get knocked out or overpowered over and over and over. We say that all the time. Ryan actually had a good one where it was like, why does Kira keep... Does wish you know how to fight is just blocking hits with her sword. Why doesn't she use her sword to actually make hits? And then when we do finally see her make hits, then it ends up hurting herself. And I'm just like, this stupid show. So, yeah, it's trash. T-rash. Welcome to our trash world. Welp. And talk about that for my cow and I. Let's see. It's been 3 episodes, but I feel like there isn't going to be a satisfactory resolution to this Dread Doctor's B storyline or any of the other storylines. It's looking like Mason and Corey are going to be a decent pairing, unlike Liam and Hayden, which makes me feel bad for Sprays because I do like his character. I'm so indifferent to Liam. I could take him or leave him. I go back and forth with Hayden. I think Hayden had a lot of promise, but they just don't know what to do with her, and they don't have the time to figure it out. She gives some great side eye. She gives some great, like, line readings, but then they give her the dumbest things to say. So you're just like, well, sorry. Sorry, hey.
I was like, do you want me to grab it for you?
I wanted the spray. Oh, there we go. Thank you.
Oh, honey.
What do you think, Mama?
What?
About Layden, and are they going to resolve the Dread Doctors?
Did they resolve anything?
Girl. I literally think they wrote themselves into a corner.
From season 1 about Peter being a villain and the Hell House and fire. But I know now that would never be answered. I had questions about Kate coming back as the Bone Woman. I had questions about the Argents since day 1. I had questions about Gerard and where the hell everyone that was an Argent family member or co-op. They used to roll deep. Do anyone remember that when they used to come up even with Chris rolling like with like 20 people?
Argent had people.
I remember when they first came up on Tyler. I mean, as for some of y'all who know Derek, when Derek still had that really nice car, they rode up on Derek with 10 people. I was like, and where y'all hoes go? Mm-hmm. Where did you guys go? Because you used to have a family. I was like, I don't understand where all these people disappear to. Do they just not have time for extras anymore? Everyone just disappeared, like the daggone cops in this town disappeared and their talent disappeared.
Girl.
Sorry.
Exactly. But
I
mean,
like, I still have questions about where Harris is. I have questions about everything.
Oh, poor Harris. I want to ask poor Adam Fristo.
I love Harris.
Let's get him on the podcast.
I had a crush on...
I know.
I loved Harris. I was here for Harris every single day.
Every day of the week.
They screwed his character over so bad because he was supposed to be more important in that damn show. Mm-hmm. They screwed him over and they even knew he was going to be more important. This makes me mad.
It's so messy.
I'm sorry, but there's so many things I just...
Mess. Yeah. So we'll see what happens. Okay, so do you think the whole Skinwalker thing actually has a purpose? Or do you think it's just Jeff trying to throw as much random mythology into the show because he always says how much he loves different mythology? I just don't see how they tie into the Kitsune mythology. They don't seem to cross paths anywhere since a Kitsune is a Japanese fox spirit, and Skinwalkers are people with the ability to turn into any animal they desire. Huh. And are from Native American folklore. Thoughts? I don't know. We actually talk a lot about this on the podcast, but most of it consists of, I don't know. Sorry, I don't know. I just don't know. Homegirl Maya made this fantastic article where it took all these different opinions from all these different people watching the show, and the consensus was, I don't know.
Well, I mean, can we quote Scott?
I don't know.
God, I miss him. I really miss him and Isaac's dynamic. That was such a good dynamic.
It was good.
But I'll be honest, like, what's the best way? I never really knew after a while anyway what was happening. This season, I definitely don't know.
This season is crazy. Because when you think about just the doctors... Who are they? Where did they come from? How did they find these kids to do these original surgeries, much less come back later and then do some more surgeries? Are there more chimeras out there? What's the deal with Theo? And those are just questions that we had from last season.
Yeah.
And so they're and then we know we're going to get even more characters in the next few episodes because there were characters seen in the trailer, in the mid-season trailer. In the mid-season trailer that we still haven't seen, we haven't heard from, we don't know what's going on.
As for the mythology thing, like every season, what do I say? I hate the fact that they're taking this mythology. I hope they don't ruin this mythology. I know more about this mythology
than they do.
And it's really sad because I keep saying this over and over again. As someone who studied art history and my emphasis was non-Western art, learning that form of history, you learn mythology. And it hurts because I'm just like, they keep fucking up with the stuff I love.
Mm-hmm.
I know more about Native American mythology just because as a kid, I liked reading what little bit I could. I have family that's Native American. And, like, it's hurtful. And I knew they were going to fuck it up. I kept saying it. They mm-hmm. were going to whitewash it, or they were going to fuck it up. And what do? They fuck it up.
Well, we just saw that girl's booty, all of her booty glory in that shot.
And I can't even say anything about that. I was like, and the thing is that, let's be honest, like, the Skinwalker thing is not just Native American lore. Like I said on the podcast, there's African Skinwalker stories and...
Well, this one, I know specifically is supposed to be Native American,
We know. Well, I know. Skinwalkers
are
best known.
Or whatever.
Well, Skinwalkers are best known from Native mythology. But mm-hmm. the thing is, or from American Indian mythology. But the thing is that just the way they're doing it is just so wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just like, you fucked up mythology from every place. You at least give one season where you're like, you know what? We're going to care. And you just don't do it.
Not even, But the thing is, they like to mix mythology with seemingly no rhyme or reason. Why are you putting the berserkers with Kate, with La Loba, and the Texualpias and all this other stuff? Why are they together? Why have them be a thing? You have the Oni with Kira and them was enough because at least they were related, but now you have the Oni and the Skinwalkers and Kira, and somehow they're all related, but you're not gonna tell us how. I don't know, it's just extremely stupid. It's stupid. Let's see what's next. If Scott really wanted to get his pack together, why dismiss Liam like that? He was right there and was willing to put everything that happened between them behind them. Yet Scott's like, I just have to go on this long trip to New Mexico and find Kieran. You can't come because no. Like, what? We talk about a lot about that on the podcast. And then also, I thought it was a very nice tick, but I don't feel like Scott understood. I don't feel like Scott got the brunt of it. When Styles was like, when he was like, you didn't see the way he looked at me. And Styles is like, I've seen you under a full moon. I know exactly how he looked at you. And for Scott to just kind of dismiss that and be like, oh, well, and not think about how to deal with Liam. Again, he's not resolving any of these issues. He's making them come to him, beg him for forgiveness while he thinks about if he wants to deal with them. This is your sire. You don't have a choice. Nut up and deal with your issues.
I like the fact that you said that
up, though. Yeah. And so, yeah, we talk a lot about that a lot, and I agree it's trash. Let's see. Controlly. Mr. Harris in the wolf and sheep's clothing. Hope you enjoy. May want to tell Momo, because I know she loves Peter and Harris, and maybe she enjoy them together. I'll post that link, you guys. Thank you, Nani. Oh my God, send it to me. I don't know who is doing the fig wreck, Nani, but I love you. Keep it coming.
Thank you so much. Please make sure that you link me to that so I will. I can see it and
read it. I definitely will.
Y'all know. I love the fact that someone out there remembered that I loved Harris so much, because... Mm-hmm. Literally, I think today was the first time
that we've talked about him in a while.
And the fact that someone either listened to old podcasts or had a great memory to remember that I loved Harris was a fave. For those who don't know,
I couldn't stand Harris.
For those who don't know, I had the hugest crush on Harris. He was like the geeky type, glasses wearing type guy that I love. And I was just like, I'm here for all of this mess that I know he's going to bring. And he was constantly just guilt-tripping the team.
Well, he's always in fix with Styles. Like, always ragging on Styles. And always cracks me up.
Because he did that in class, and I was here for it. He was like, do you need to go out to the bathroom too? I know,
like, dang, Harris, you hate. And that's probably why I didn't like him. I was like, he's so mean to Styles.
But you know what? If we look back on it now, we do that recap with Meg, since Meg hasn't really seen the first season.
Mm-hmm.
God, you probably love him so much.
Okay.
But the fact that they did him so wrong, because he knew something about Kate, and he had a link to the Argents.
I know.
I was so pissed off about that, because he had a link to the Argents, and we knew he was about to spill everything about the Hellfire.
Yeah.
And what did they do? Harris disappeared.
We don't even have a confirmation that he's dead.
We never got a confirmation that he was dead. He just disappeared during the time that the Rock was
exactly.
there.
Exactly. And they counted him, but
the thing is that a bunch of teachers disappeared.
And like Mr. O'Quinn.
We never knew exactly how many actually disappeared. And on top of that, we never saw his body, where we saw the bodies from a lot of the teachers were if you think about it, the teachers were the only group that she killed that we didn't see bodies for.
Yeah.
That was always a little odd to me. Because you saw the bodies for all the other groups of people that the Rock was killing as a sacrifice, except for them. Maybe it was just to keep Harris a secret. If Harris ends up being the Beast, I would be like, thank you for throwing that thing back for me.
That would be kind of interesting, but they have to do so much explaining.
But they
explaining.
Keep saying it's a teenager.
It didn't say I don't know.
I can't with them.
It's all so, messy. Looking for a blind alpha who isn't even blind anymore since 3A, thanks to Jennifer. Exactly. I don't know. We'll see. Cole the Wolf. Cole, you're stupid. He says, what? There was a new episode this week? Nothing trended, and the only thing that happened this week was Hoechlin's improv, right? Oops. You stupid.
Cole, every time.
Hoechlin's improv, that was a fun, fun night. That was ridiculous. No, on Twitter and everything, when we would get in the details that came out. Everyone was just kind
of throwing out the shade and stuff. It was
so funny.
Because I'm sorry, I saw a part of the little bit of that song, and I was just like, we can tell you haven't done improv before.
No, I do like the,
I'm just saying.
I do like when he's singing the one that won't, but he was just so nervous, which was adorable, I'm like, okay,
come on. I do remember you showing me that, and then he was trying to sing, what was the other song that he was singing?
I was about to say Bohemian Rhapsody. Not Champagne Supernova, but...
Wonderwall.
Thank you. I always get those two mixed up. Yes,
we're two black girls that know our Oasis songs. Damn it.
Oh my god, I used
Champagne Supernova is still my heart. Mm-hmm. That song, you can put that song on right now and I'm like, where's my candlestick?
Champagne Supernova in the sky. How many damn, but damn, but damn.
Okay, I was going for the rest of the chorus.
I have to, because I have to where start, you, because I get it mixed up high. With Hello? The other ones I'm so much. I know. So they're walking down the hall, faster than a cannonball. Where were you when we were getting high? Something
is someone's gonna
find me caught up in the landslide and a champagne supernova in the sky. Someday you will find me caught up in the landslide. A champagne supernova, cause we all believe that we're gonna get home for the summer, cause you and I will never die. Why?
Just remember, people, I did grow up in the hood, but you know, you knew
but
that song.
But we also grew up in the early to mid 90s.
My mom listened to
and that. Oasis was everything.
I mean, and the thing is, my mom listened to like everything. Like, my mom was like, I'm gonna play you some Billy Idol. They're Bowie, Tears for Fears, but you're also going to listen to Tupac at the same time.
Oh, no, like, but no, we're talking Oasis, but, so we're talking, like,
but no, my mom
Soundgarden
likes,
and,
my mom
like,
playing Oasis. My mom
Stone
little,
Temple Pilots. Yeah. And
I played a lot of Stone
yeah,
Temple Pilots.
Yeah, Guns N' Roses and Aerosmith, when Aerosmith had that whole string one. Don't get me started on November Rain. That song used to make me cry.
So one of my
I used
friends,
to be obsessed
that used to
with
be
November
our...
Rain.
November Rain used to be our go-to karaoke duet song.
It's like a
19-minute
song, and I did not care. Because
you don't
minute.
Care, because back then you had those epic songs.
You
that
had the time.
Every album had to have at least one song that was over 10 minutes. Every album.
And November Rain, god dang it.
You were just like, I'm here for all the
time. And Jeremy, I was obsessed with.
Mm-hmm.
Blind Melon, of course, the Honey Bee song.
See, I didn't like that song that
really?
Much. I was that weird person who just didn't get it.
I loved it.
I didn't get it at all.
Because it was one of those songs that you didn't even really need to know.
But see, that's
like,
the thing
I
think.
All I can say is that my life is pretty plain.
I know the song, but I'm just.
But the thing is,
something that bugged me is that we didn't have to know.
I loved it.
I like knowing my lyrics.
Do you remember Crash Test Dummies?
Yes.
Do you remember Mr. Big?
Yes.
I was obsessed with Mr. Big.
Oh my God.
I'm the one who wants to be with you.
No. So, my friend, Jamika, who's a fellow makeup artist, she went up to the Wendy Williams show.
Mm-hmm.
Guess who they had on?
Who?
Diddy Kane.
That's what you were telling me about.
I was
that.
Like, I hate you right now. Cause I'm like, bitch, Big Daddy, that's a legend.
Oh,
I was
my
like,
God.
That is a fucking legend. She's like, yeah, I know.
Ah!
So New York represent. I was like, I hate you.
Oh my God.
I was so mad. I'm sorry. I was just like, 90s dream just dropped. 80 streams just dropped. Like, you can't do this to me. I'm like, they already had Monica on there. Then they're going to have Big Daddy King. How are you going to do that to me?
That's Wendy. Every now and again, Wendy will come correct, but it's never when you expect it.
She's
just
love,
never ready.
The thing I love is that she always has these black artists, and she'd be pulling them out.
Yep.
I was like, how the hell you get Shaka Khan to perform? Shaka Khan doesn't perform for
anybody.
Shaka doesn't perform for anyone. Got Mary J. Blige up there and had a dang on Whispers. I had to stay home. the day that they had the whispers on there. And she was like, I don't care if you guys don't know. She's like, I know my audience is yelling, but I'm going to have the whispers on here anyway. And I was like, you're going to rock. I was like, yes.
That is cute.
I was like, I'm all here for this. I'm going to sing everything. I was like, I am freaking a 6-year-old woman.
And loving it. Loving it. Killing hoes.
That's not that bad.
Girl.
That hurts my soul.
Yeah.
I didn't know Genesis, though. How do you not know Genesis?
I don't know. So, Ryan with Cupcake says, can someone tell Kira that the port of sword fighting isn't to hit the other person's weapon? How does she expect to win a fight if she never aims for the squishy parts? We saw her get a couple of swipes in, but even then, she's skirt. But that's what the fox is for. And we talk about that on the podcast, about how, like, the fox is actually okay. And the fox seems to like her and to be doing well. So I don't know what the problem is. It's the show creating drama where there definitely is no drama. Cue for your A's. Did you like the second episode, Shadowhunters? We haven't watched it. I'm going to put it on after we get done with these Q&As. Hey, just a quick question. That one we'll answer later. The best scenes in the new episode were between Styles and Roscoe. When a Jeep has more screen presence and can act out your main character, you're in big trouble. Wow. Wait for Posey to have a crab fit about how people shouldn't be watching the show for a car. That's why I said the Roscoe scenes were blatant. I think that Posey is mad about it. I really do. I don't think he said anything and anything specific.
Why would he say anything?
But, well, he doesn't have to. But even the comments that they have him make in the show, where they're like, oh, you didn't fix the gas tank, and I think your car is overheating. And I'm like, he's taking you a 15-hour trip on this broke-down Jeep. Of course it's overheating. What did you think was going to happen? And why are you trying to rag on Styles about it when he's doing this for you and your girl so that you can go get it in? So, I don't know. You're a dick, Scott. Stop being a dick. You're better than that. Can we take a minute to appreciate the fact that many of us got involved in this fandom due to loving the show? But the reason we stuck around in this fandom despite no longer supporting the show is due to a mixture of spite and satisfaction in seeing it tank. started out united in love, and we're still only here, but now we're united in hate. Talk about coming full circle. Or in Teen Wolf's case, two circles tattooed on Scott's arm. It's also the chemistry of the cast. Especially the older cast, and the way that they really interacted with each other and the way that they just kind of endeared themselves to us. I think it was so telling that at Hoechlin's debut, so much of the cast was there, the former cast, but none of the recent cast. I'm not including Dob for obvious reasons, but when you think about the only person that really knows Hoechlin that is in this current cast is Posey. I am actually surprised, not only that Posey isn't there, but evidently Britt Snow stopped following Posey on Twitter. Like, really? Unfollowed him. And Posey still does a lot of work with Jed and with Love is Louder. And so I'm just like, ooh.
What happened?
Yeah.
You know, it takes so much for people to unfollow you, especially when you're famous and you're in the cycle.
Exactly. Like, there's no, like, she broke up with Hex so long ago and they're still following each other.
Yeah, I was going to say.
What happened with Posey?
I was going to say, is she still following the other Tyler?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, wow. It's messy. So we'll see if any 97 deets on that. Y'all let me know. Because I don't be following Britt like that. Let's go. And then we'll refresh. We'll do a few more. Okay, I'm an old-time slasher. So far, I thought shipping and name combinations like Steric were for romantic couples. Recently, that changed and includes now platonic, too. And all fandoms are only Teen Wolf. I'm not sure how I feel about that. I want a clear distinction. I don't want to hear Posey talking about shipping Skiles or in meaning being best bros. I feel cheated and my fan kink dissolved into something else. Slash was a proud liberating feminist movement. Seems to be forgotten. I think it's a way of him towing the line. Of him being like, oh yeah, I ship Styles and Scott. But then being able to be like, as bros. And then not having to kind of worry about the ramifications.
That's when I like to say...
Yeah, exactly.
That's what he's trying to say. They're no homo way yet. But if he says it out loud, you know, he'll get a lot of hate.
Like, he loves Scott and Styles, but they're not going to be walking down the street wearing backpacks and holding hands anytime soon. So.
There's some stuff on that.
Exactly. And
I
will
maybe one day they can have, you know, if I was running on Teen Wolf, I would totally just write that in. Just pure, be like, I'm going to make this a dream sequence.
Exactly.
Just to get to him.
Scott and Styles, holding hands, wearing backpacks, purple Jan sports. let's see. Yeah. I mean, I understand what you mean. I think it's just a matter of shipping becoming more, not universal, but more widespread. More and more people are starting to learn what it is and kind of understand it. So you're going to kind of, you're not going to get the dissemination that you usually do. I recently just discovered that when you're looking at fanfic, if it says so-and-so slash someone, that's a romantic pairing. But if it says so-and-so ampersand someone, like and someone, that's a friendship pairing. And I didn't know that at all. And so I always wonder why they had the two different distinctions.
Wait, what are you talking about?
In fanfic, when you're looking at the tags. Mm-hmm. So like if it's like Derek Hale slash Styles Stilinski, that's steric. That's romantic steric.
Yeah.
If it's Derek Hale and Styles Stilinski, it's steric bros. It's like the not, it's either pre-slash or the non-romantic stuff, and I didn't realize
it depends.
That.
Yeah, that does pop up a lot, but it also depends on if they just say if it's just friendship or something like that. They sometimes will mark if it's just a friendship ship.
Well, that is supposed to be what the marking is, evidently, because some girl got on me. I said, because she had Derek and Styles, and then she had Styles and Lydia. And I was like, what happened with the Styles and Lydia part? Because I'm interested to see how that works in. And she was like, well, I clearly marked it with an ampersand. So it's just friends. And I'm like, you need to calm down.
Like, well, and I don't know. Maybe because I'm from like, salty. Since I'm from that old school fan fiction world where you still, even if you did do a slash, you still marked it as friendship or you still marked it as certain things that let people know, okay, this won't be romantic. I knew the and part meant friendship, but I didn't know people got so serious about it now.
Yeah, they do.
People are so serious about the terminology now. I can tell you guys, this will show you how old I am, how much this shit has changed. Mm-hmm. I remember when they didn't even have an X rating or any of that extra, they used to say how limited it was. If it was a little citrus, or they were like, oh, this is going to have a lot of lemon in it. Especially in the anime community, if you guys know what I'm talking about, the old school anime community, your fan fiction, that was what you said. You didn't have this, oh, rated X, rated R, this is going to have this type of kink or whatever, whatever.
Explicit.
You said a little bit of lemon, that means you might get a kiss or something, or maybe a little bit of touching, and then you said this will have a whole bunch of lemon, just spread it all over it, and you're like, that's going to mean they're going to get it on and get it everywhere.
Corn cob.
Have you ever heard that term?
I haven't. The only time I've heard lemon was in reference to a lemon party.
No, that's an old school fan fiction term.
That's before my time, but I like it.
Especially for anime. I can send you
eat the cake, anime.
I can send you a lot of fan fiction, even from like the Harry Potter fan fiction. That was early fan fiction. That's what they used to say. They would tell you how much lemon was in it.
That's
or how
cute.
Much citrus. It was hilarious. And I was like, and I was so, because I went for like a whole year or two without reading fan fiction, all of a sudden changed. I was like, what's the lemon rating for this?
I like that a lot, actually.
I was like, I don't know.
So,
God, I'm so old.
Let's
don't
see.
Let this young face fool you. I'm ancient.
The F is up with Miss Marden all of a sudden. She was Lydia's support base in the early seasons. And really, no, she wasn't, dear. Mama had one good mama moment with Lydia. And that was after she had, like, the sixth man running through her bed. So, no. Mama Marden has never been on hands-on mom. And let's see.
I still wish they kind of had went the route with her and Peter.
Right. Hilarious. Girl. Leaving your daughter in an effed up asylum that's clearly void of any real care for patients. No. What is this messy writing? We actually talk about this on the podcast about how I think they're just trying to slowly character assassinate all of the parents. Like, I think Mama McCall's is coming next at some point. They already did it with Sheriff. They're already, even though now they're trying to be like, oh no, the sheriff is fine. But I'm like, no, what the sheriff did and said is not fine. And there's a big problem with it. I really need to know what Jeff Steele is with his parents. There's got to be a story there that is just heartbreaking. Because I'm like, you make no sense on a regular level, but especially not on any kind of levels on a thing. There's one for you, Momo. It says, I miss antipsychotics, pill popping, anger management issues, Liam. I thought he was going to make a comeback from the past episode, but then Mason showed up. Scott's such a failure. It's no wonder his beta is so disappointing. The apple doesn't fall far. Welp.
There's a lie, though. There's no lie there.
There's no lies detected.
I just say, I love the people who are making my day remembering all the stuff I loved in the past. Because seriously, they dealt with his anger so fast. And I was just like, this is the same boy who fucked up someone's car. But then
they didn't, because they had to tie Liam to a tree.
But no. The so, thing is yeah. that it's one of those things where they still haven't really solved it, but they kind of gloss over the majority of it. Mm-hmm. And I'm just like, do you guys remember that supposedly pre-werewolf, he fucked up someone's car? I was like, people, you had to tie him into
a pre-werewolf. Pre-werewolf.
I still think he was something. Exactly. But, you know, we won't talk about that, will we? I'm like, remember when we had to fucking put him in a damn tub and leave him locked up? I
was and like, tape him up?
Yes. I was like, this is what I miss. The Liam that you had to put down to stay down. Because I'm like, Liam, if they had done Liam right, he could have been a damn enforcer. Because Liam looked like he could fuck someone up. But I'm like, I'm happy with that. If he didn't cry so much. I miss crying Liam so much. Do you guys understand how much I miss crying Liam? I needed him to either be really angry or really, like, a bitch when it kept to crying. And now it's like they want him right there, but they just don't push him. And then Scott, I need Scott to go to some type of parenting class to learn how to parent his children.
I know. I need him to go to class and get an egg, a bag of flour, whatever they do to show them taking care of babies now. I need him to go and find that because it's getting dire at this point. Okay, so we have two more that I really want to do. The first one says, Kimalia stands, please understand that luring someone out to kill them is not self-defense. Hunting someone down to kill them is not self-defense. It's premeditated murder. Even if her mommy tried to kill her a long time ago, it'd still be premeditated murder. It's one thing if the Desert Wolf showed up in Beacon Hills, and then, you know, Malia's like, okay, we gotta put an end to this because she's too close. She's going to hurt me and my friends. That's not what's happening. Malia is leaving hints to let her mom know that she's still alive so that she'll come after her to kill her. That's a problem. And I don't understand why they're acting like Malia's in the right and that Scott can't say anything about it. It's very strange. And then to put Brayden in this situation where, yeah, Brayden is supposed to be this mercenary, but we've never actually seen her do anything that's mercenary-like, you know? And so it's like, you have a chance to redeem her, but now you're putting her as a very obvious accomplice to this murder plot for no reason.
Every single freaking time they had the chance to make her a mercenary, they fucked up
something. They messed it up. So now Brayden is like, oh, well, when I was a U.S. Marshal, I was trying to find the Desert Wolf. To kill her? Why? And the stuff that we've seen, she's actually more of a Robin Hood. She seems to be taking out bad guys. Yeah. She's not killing innocent people. So I don't understand what her story is, why it's okay that this plot line is happening without any interruption.
Then again, the orphans were just killing off supernatural people, but they act like they were fucking criminals too.
Yep, so, they acted like they were evil.
So that's why I said maybe Scott and all of them are actually the evil ones and we just don't know it.
I like that theory a lot. I like that a lot. Can I touch your hair? Yeah.
Ooh. I want my hair to be like that.
Your hair is like that.
Oh, it's not. Mm-hmm. Do you feel this shit? It's not.
It's nice.
I want it nicer.
Yay.
I want it pretty like yours.
Aw. So, okay, so the last one, it says, obviously, you don't have to. So this Anon sent in this thing about the improv, and they're like, I don't understand why everybody has second hand or was worried about Hoechlin. He's been doing improv for years. He goes to these conventions all the time, and you guys just eat it up. And like this really kind of rude thing where it was just being like really shady to the other nannies.
Is that you?
I think so, but I don't. It's my. Like, why did it all of a sudden start making noise?
I was like, that's not my phone, because my phone is on buzzing.
Yeah. And so, it says, obviously, you don't have to post this, but I'm the nanny that sent in... Oh, is Micah, what? Is he online?
Oh, no. We're talking about something.
Oh, Lord.
Whatever, Stacey. Every time that I ever talk to Micah about comic books, or I remember especially was it Captain America we were talking about, and you were just rolling your eyes.
Yes, because we were talking about Teen Wolf,
and me and Mike were having a separate conversation exactly about what comic books we were waiting
while
for.
while we were recording about Teen Wolf.
No, I don't even think that we. I think we were on a break.
No,
we were on a break.
There's no such thing as a break. A break is just when you start talking about something else.
No, you went to get food or something, and Micah. And I were talking about other shit. Stuff that's just as important to us. She just doesn't like the fact that me and Micah have this bond where it's like, we need to talk about like everything
we
else.
We need to
that
get Micah back on.
God, it would be amazing.
Ask him if he's watching Shadowhunters.
Oh, okay, let me ask.
All right. So, it says, it really wasn't meant to be shady at all. I'm sorry if there's something in the wording that implies that. There was a lot in the wording, boo. I truly believe that celebrities' public persona is a form of improv, even if they are playing themselves. They might share some things about themselves, but they are being paid to play to a crowd. I think Hoechlin's answers on certain subjects change depending on how he's feeling the crowd. That's perfectly fine, but it's not what you said. And within the context, it wasn't what you said. It was basically saying you guys are all stupid for believing that Tyler Hoechlin couldn't perform because he performs in front of you all the time. And I get very, very cagey because I know a lot of Hoechlin stans. And just like I shade the ones that think that he's their son or he's their brother and they know him and, you know, all this other stuff, I also shade the ones that are like, well, you don't know anything about him because he does put himself out there. I've seen it personally. I don't ever think he's 100%. And he's probably never going to be, which is totally fine by me, which is totally fine by a lot of his stands. But there's no need to kind of bring attention to something that we know explicitly unless he starts lying, which when he does, then we do. So, I'll answer that one later. Aiden is so funny. She is not watching at all. Forever. I know, and she just puts the funniest
That's
things.
Who we need to have on the show.
Mm-hmm.
Girl, you better get up on the show. How many more things are we going to answer? I'm ready to watch Shadowhunters and go to sleep.
I know. I just wanted to see if there was anything. That's funny. It says, okay, but the Damnatio Memoriae script looked like word art from 1999. LMAO, does this show even try? That's fantastic.
man, I haven't heard that reference in so long.
Shadow Trash, love it. We still have to do something for that.
Wait, does this mean we're actually Shadow Hunter trash now?
Pretty
from
much.
From one episode?
With Shade Finders.
But let's be honest, it's just sad. It's one episode and it already did better. Outside of the fact that the two main leads just really don't have chemistry. But maybe they'll grow. Maybe they'll learn. I don't know. But, I mean, let's be honest. Plot-wise, they seem like they already have a Bible. They already have better graphics. How the hell are you going to be, just on your first episode, already have better graphics than a show that's been on for 5 seasons?
Exactly. Oh my god.
I was like, Teen Wolf, come on. I was like,
Yeah, let me finish my last.
Even their makeup and special effects, like their actual practical makeup, was better. Mm-hmm. How does that even work?
It doesn't. It's so stupid.
I've never seen a show like that before. That like just like let's just you know give our all the first time around. And even Shamalamada.
Oh yeah, their effects were on point.
I was like, you guys just.
And then we have the same old tired green screen in Teen Wolf. And you're just like...
That green screen for the background for their outside. Was awful.
It was outside. It looked like a window screensaver.
You're telling me you couldn't go outside at night?
You couldn't just go outside? You have night shoots. Like, that's the entire point. I didn't understand. That pissed me off
so much.
I did not understand. But whatever. This silly show.
That pissed me off, yo.
All right. This is the final twist. And so I think it is time to say goodnight. Say goodnight, Mama.
Goodnight. We're gonna farewell.
If we'd have sang goodbye, I bow and say a kiss to you. Goodnight. Goodnight. The sun has gone to bed and so must I. So long, farewell, auf Wiedersehen, goodbye, good night.
Good night, people.
Good night.
Good night, people.
Good night.
I still want a koala, Ryan.
Good night.